please stand? Good morning. As we gather on this momentous occasion, recognizing our diversity in faith traditions and beliefs, but honoring our unity in gratitude, let's reflect on all that is yet to be while expressing thanks for the gifts of intellect, goals met, the support of family, friends, and mentors, and an environment that encourages education. Grateful for the dedication of faculty and staff, let us ask for blessing on the mission of Westchester and all those who work to fulfill it. As we look to the future, let us embrace the opportunities that come our way, but be mindful of the challenges. Let us use the knowledge and skills we have gained to make a positive difference in the world. May we be inspired to seek truth and wisdom, to act with integrity and compassion, and strive for excellence in all that we do. We ask for guidance and strength as we embark on this new chapter of our lives. Let us be empowered to make a positive impact on our communities, remembering the values and lessons we have learned here. You may be seated.
Welcome, administration, faculty, staff, coaches, trustees, family members, and my fellow graduates. Speaking for myself and my classmates, I can confidently say that we have been counting down to this moment all year. Today is the day to celebrate all that we have accomplished over the past 13 years, reflect on the great memories, and be together one more time before we each go our separate ways. As we move through this final gathering, we will hear from this class's valedictorian and salutatorian, along with faculty speakers, as they share thoughtful reflections about our time here together and highlight the amazing memories that we have made. This small class of 24 incredible individuals would not have made it to this point without each and every person in this room and their support that they bring to us. Congratulations, Westchester's class of 2023. We finally made it.
Good morning. Growing up at Westchester, we seniors have always loved the seating in the Finch Center, and we're sad to see it go in 2021. Whether it was after a long day of quizzes and tests, or we just needed a warm place to wait in the winter, we were provided with a comforting place to go. Our goal with the senior gift was to bring back that comfortable seating and provide a lasting, comfortable space for students to sit and spend their time together for years to come. Recognizing the importance of having a dedicated area for relaxation and socializing, the seniors wanted to create an environment where future students can forge connections and create cherished memories. With these goals in mind, the senior class has chosen to donate seating to the Finch Center in the form of 4 tables and 8 chairs, lining the sides of the lobby. We look forward to enhancing the overall student experience at Westchester and ensuring that upcoming generations have a welcoming and inviting place to gather and enjoy their time in the Finch Center. It is now my honor to present this check to Mr. Atkinson on behalf of the class of 2023.
The salutatorian of the class of 2023 is Ruhan Upadhyay. Ruhan is the 2022 recipient of the Science Department Award and the 2023 recipient of the Good Citizen Award. He will attend North Carolina State University in the fall to study horticulture. Congratulations, Ruhan. The valedictorian of the class of 2023 is Aliana Schwartz. Ali is the 2022 recipient of the Rothrock Scholarship for Excellence in English and the 2023 Student Government Award, English Department Award, and the Science Department Award. Ali will attend the University of Virginia in the fall as a Jefferson Scholar with plans to study biology and psychology. Congratulations, Ali. The Peter M. Cowan Outstanding Senior Award was named in 2003 as a special recognition for Mr. Peter M. Cowan, who served as head of school from 1991 to 2003. The intent of the Board of Trustees was to recognize with this award Mr. Cowan's great affection for Westchester students. This award is given to a senior selected by the faculty as best portraying the qualities of character, integrity, citizenship, leadership, and scholarship. This year's recipient of the Peter M. Cowan Outstanding Senior Award is Aliana Schwartz. Congratulations, Ali. We will now hear from our salutatorian and valedictorian.
Mr. Atkinson, Mrs. Kiever, Mrs. Briggs, my beloved Westchester faculty, family, and friends of those so precious, and also my fellow graduates, welcome. At the beginning of this year, I felt as though a chapter opened for the entirety of my class, a chapter that was filled with greater connections and the blossoming of a supportive community. This community together forms a web, one that can be easily traversed by each of us, one of love and joy. We all have learned many valuable lessons and felt a variety of emotions throughout this chapter. That has all passed. Now, at the end of this chapter, we who have come collectively as a massive wave must go forth and crash into this world, cause our destruction, and eventually fall back into the waters from which we came. Thus is the beauty of the ebb and flow of life. It only took 1 year for this great wave to rise, and yet only a moment for it to realize that it too must crash and in its separation go forth and nourish the earth. Let us take a moment to savor the rise of our wave and the beautiful nourishment that it will bring upon this world, and not forget to supply the world with each of our collective graces so we can watch the fruits of our efforts grow together. There were some days where I felt one sort of way, leaning towards any negative emotion. Yet I would come into school, and not even within 10 minutes, I would see the beautiful faces of all my classmates. Them just being who they all are, interacting with one another, and every feeling that I was trying to hold on to would just vanish into the classroom air. Everyone here is so special. Whether you realize it or not, each and every single one of you has helped in the rearing of this class, whether you taught them how to act or how not to act. But I'm saying it once more, that we appreciate all of your efforts, even if not mentioned individually. As a class, each and every single one of you has attributed to me opening my eyes on any given school day. On some days it was harder than others to get up, but I feel like that's something that all of us have experienced. It was harder to just be present, yet I would see you all being who you are and just know that I was never alone, and especially never justified to feel anything but overwhelming joy. We were always told, and most likely will be told, for the rest of our lives, that we must do this or that. And for some reason, we rarely hear the words, just be who you want to be, do what you want to do. So I'm telling each and every single one of you to just be yourself. The self that in its simplest expression brings me so much wealth and has taught me so much. I feel as though it is my duty to remind you all of the fact that you'll never be alone. Because whether you like it or not, I will always be there for every single one of you all, in your hearts, minds, souls, and in your little phones. Though we weren't a class that spent a lot of time together as a whole, through our collective experiences in some of our favorite teachers' classrooms, the senior lounge, and in those senior sessions, we formed a spirit and a body. This body consists of us together right now, right here. It's one that can be broken physically, but the spirit of this class is something that can never be forgotten. Let us not be trapped by our own fears or hopes, regrets or successes, and temptations or dreams. For if I learned anything from all our time together, it was that bliss could only be found in the moment, in the simple laughter and in the beautiful silence. Every future moment stems from this one, and all the past moments come together here. And now, at our graduation, something so long awaited, yet so speedily here. I've heard it from each and every one of you, that this year has gone by with the blink of an eye. Let us appreciate this moment, because our future can only be found here, and will never be outside of this moment. Westchester has become my school because of each and every single one of you all. Let us march forward and keep the simple reminder that nature makes no mistakes, only happy little accidents. Each one has a lesson to be grasped, and then with ease we can sweep the experiences away. Perhaps the lesson right now is for us to simply enjoy the feelings today, right here at our graduation, and cherish this precious fleeting event. Congratulations, class of 2023. Ladies
and gentlemen, dedicated faculty members, proud parents, and my fellow graduating class of 2023, we made it. Today is our finish line. For 9 of us, this race began 13 years ago on our brightly colored carpet squares in Mrs. Horney's classroom, where Annabeth lost a tooth and Caroline belted out her newest self-written song. Whether you've been at Westchester in this race for 3 or 13 years, today is a milestone, a finish line. Today is the day we bid farewell to the place that laid the foundation for who we will be and what we will become, and we say goodbye to the people who shaped us. Now, before I get much farther, let me introduce myself. I am Ollie Schwartz. Many of you may know me as the student government president or a runner on the cross country and track team, or maybe even as Coach Schwartz's daughter. But one thing you definitely don't know me for is my singing. I am no lead singer, but I often think of our senior class like a garage band. Each of us playing different instruments, but uniting to create a collective, unreplicable harmony. We have lost and gained members along the way, and we even had to take a 2-month hiatus due to a pandemic. But nevertheless, we persisted. So today, I am going to share with you the Class of 2023 playlist, but don't worry, I will not be singing any songs. Now back to those carpet squares in Mrs. Horney's classroom. Similar to Aladdin and Princess Jasmine from the movie Aladdin, Grayson, Beau, Caleb, Madeline, Annabeth, Lucy, Caroline, the other Madeline, and I were entering a whole new world with 100,000 things to see. We were riding our magic carpets while simultaneously learning the intricacies of properly writing every letter of the alphabet. This mile of our race was filled with enchanting adventures, forming friendships, dazzling dreams, and new horizons to pursue. As we moved down Smith Hall, we grew taller and smarter. We learned how to read and how to do long division. We tried tirelessly to keep our cards on green and competed fiercely on the playground in games of soccer, kickball, foursquare, and the infamous wall ball. We were living by our problem-free philosophy, Hakuna Matata. It means no worries for the rest of your days. Lower school was a time of growth, fun, and a love of pizza dippers. A time when Bo dominated the dodgeball games during PE, and Grayson beat us all at around-the-world multiplication tables with Mrs. Driver. We longed for the freedom of not walking in a line, and we couldn't get to middle school fast enough. Then middle school finally arrived, and well, it was middle school. It was a time of petty arguments and sprinting to the front of the lunch line. We channeled our competitive energy into real sports and felt so cool wearing our uniforms for the first time. Like Gabriella sang in High School Musical, "Everyone is special in their own way. We make each other strong. We're not the same. We're different in a good way. Together's where we belong. We're all in this together." Middle school might not have been the best years of our lives, as we were trying to find where we fit in and what made us different. We got through it together, though. Together, we persisted when our bus broke down on the side of the highway coming back from the Biltmore in an eighth grade field trip. We walked half a mile to the nearest gas station, where we sat on the floor and played Go Fish. Middle school was a bumpy, crazy 3 years with a few breakdowns along the way, but we made it through together. As we moved on from middle school, we didn't travel far, but we finally entered high school. As ninth graders, we were ecstatic to carry our backpacks around, go to school dances, and learn how to drive. As we walked the halls on our first day, we were like Judy Hopps from Zootopia riding into the big city. Judy stood at the front of the train, earbuds in, and blasted these lyrics from Shakira, which describe our ninth grade energy perfectly. "Birds don't just fly, they fall down and get up. Nobody learns without getting it wrong. I won't give up, no, I won't give in till I reach the end and then I'll start again." We were hopeful and excited. Little did we know what was to come. As we finished ninth grade, "unprecedented" became one of the most used words in our vocabulary. While sitting in our bedrooms on Zoom, Mr. Stern taught us about viruses and pandemics as we were living through one. We dissected pigs in our backyards and made TikToks of scenes from the Odyssey in Mr. Hunt's class. Just like Shakira sang in Zootopia, we didn't let COVID keep us down. We got back up, we didn't give in, and now we've reached the end. After an extended summer, we returned to in-person school for 10th grade, when the song "Stressed Out" by 21 Pilots described our mood. It goes, "Wish we could turn back time to the good old days, but now we're stressed out. We tried to make the most of this time, but through 10th and 11th grade, we were taking difficult classes, starting to think about where we wanted to go to college, taking standardized tests, playing soccer and basketball in masks, and living through a pandemic. This portion of our race was the uphill battle, the climb. We had to dig deep to make it through, and you could definitely say we were a little stressed out. We also made some good memories during this time, though, like the boys' soccer team winning the state championship, getting to go to our first prom, movie nights, and traveling through Virginia to visit colleges, where we watched baseball, ate dinner in a shopping mall, and went to TJ Maxx with Mrs. Moy. Although we were definitely stressed out during this time, we have many good memories to hold on to as well. Then, as COVID started to disappear from our daily headlines, we entered into our senior year. It came fast, but we were ready to be seniors. We painted our parking spots, processed in at convocation, and endured 4 days in the woods enjoying peanut butter and jelly tortillas and walking 2 miles to a real bathroom. We were almost graduates, and like Tiana sang in Princess and the Frog, we were getting closer, closer every day, and we were almost there. We were almost there. Since August 24th, we have read daily poems with Mr. Atkinson, learned valuable life lessons from Mr. Smith, shared countless laughs in the senior lounge, been accepted into college, and started imagining our future. Senior year was like the final stretch of a race, where everyone is cheering you on and the finish line is in sight. Now, as I stand behind this podium, we are all about to stop our watches and cross that finish line. So before we officially become alumni, I want to thank those who have gotten us to this point. Because as the singer my dog was named after, Kenny Chesney, sang, "I didn't get here alone. That road's just too rough and long. I might be the one the spotlight's on, but I didn't get here alone." Thank you, teachers, for all of the time, energy, and love you have put into each one of us. I truly cannot imagine being taught by more caring teachers than you all. Thank you, faculty members, for being the behind-the-scenes supporters we all need. And lastly, thank you, parents and family. Mom and Dad, thank you for never letting me quit, for coming to every sporting event and awards ceremony, for driving me to countless activities, for reading over my speeches and papers, and for being my biggest advocates. I definitely didn't get here alone, and without the words of wisdom and encouragement from you, I wouldn't be up here today. Lastly, to my fellow graduates, I will miss our time together, but we made some great memories, which I will cherish forever. I think Hannah Montana sang it better than I could ever express. I always knew this day would come, when we'd be standing one by one, with our future in our hands, so many dreams, so many plans. I always knew, after all these years, there'd be laughter, there'd be tears. But I never thought I'd walk away with so much joy, yet so much pain. And it's so hard to say goodbye. But yesterday's gone, we've got to keep moving on. I'm so thankful for the moments, so glad I got to know ya. I'll hold you in my heart forever, I'll always remember you. As all 24 of us receive our diplomas and move our tassel, it will signify that we have graduated. So as we cross the finish line of our time at Westchester and begin our next race, I want to leave you with some words of advice from a Schwartz family favorite by Michael Franti. Don't complicate it, keep it simple, just work hard and be nice to people. Oh, just work hard and be nice to people. Thank you and congratulations to the class of 2023.
And now, Mr. Atkinson and Mrs. Briggs, it is time to award the diplomas on behalf of the Board of Trustees. Madeline Sage Adams, daughter of Lisa Adams.
Madeline received a Lifetime Theater Award for her consistent participation in productions since kindergarten, when she participated in the K-12 musical production of Once Upon a Mattress, to this year's production of Moana, starring in the leading role of Grandma Tala. Her performance was heartfelt with a touch of crazy. This note from Miss Noyes fully explains Madeline for those who don't already know her. Everything about her is heartfelt. Madeline exudes confidence. She has big, effusive emotions. She leans more often than not toward humor and irreverence. Her comic timing and sarcasm are second to none. But beyond the humor and comic relief she provides her classmates, Madeline is described by her teachers as inclusive, tolerant, and accepting. Mrs. Albert explained the way Madeline's willingness to laugh at herself helped her classmates to relax. There was no longer pressure to be perfect. She is recognized as a loyal friend and the first to offer up a hug to anyone in need. I hope you continue to live fully in a heartfelt manner. even if it involves a touch of crazy every now and then. As you make your way to UNC Wilmington, congratulations, Madeline.
Connor Christian Apple, son of Chris and Rhonda Apple.
So growing up, my favorite comic was always Calvin and Hobbes. It was sometimes profound or holding deep truth, like their namesakes, John Calvin and Thomas Hobbes, but it was always hilarious. A running gag in the strip was a great noodle incident at their school. Though neither Calvin, Hobbes, nor the teacher, Mrs. Wormwood, who I guess is me, ever explained exactly what happened, it was intimated that the incident was too ludicrous or catastrophic to put into words. Little did I know, 20 years later, I'd have one such event happen in my own classroom, and it involved nothing so innocuous as noodles. What follows is no exaggeration. It is the truth, just as Connor, the most truthful man I'll ever meet, would tell it. For our macromolecules lab, students each chose a food item to blend and test for their biological compounds. Connor chose onion. They were supposed to bring in about a cup, but Honor, who always does the maximum if at all able, brought in a full liter of the noxious stuff and a very fine Yeti water bottle. We carried out the test and all was well. The students brought their items home. Connor did not. It is quite likely I did not give him a direct order to do so, and if you know Connor, that is a fatal flaw. Some months pass, and a rising stench begins to fill the room. This is quite common in my biology class, so it was some weeks before the source was identified. Connor's half-hidden liter of gelatinous onion juice had breached even the high-security confines of a highly expensive and mighty Yeti water bottle. Is that yours, Connor? Yes, I think so, Mr. Stern. Please clean it up and take it home. Yes, Mr. Stern. As you may know, Connor's a wonderfully literal-minded young man, and when he heard this dictate, he wasted no time in doing just that. Instantly, in the middle of class, he went back to the room in the middle of the lecture and prepared his task to clean up. And in the style of Amelia Bedelia, up he cleaned. In the blink of an eye, and with the force of a pound of sodium, an entire liter of onion jello was splattered onto the ceiling and across the room and all over poor Connor. Connor slowly turned around. His glasses were opaque, his eyebrows were blown upward, and he was dripping with the mephitic ooze. Excuse me, it's too funny, okay. Connor, he stammered, gosh, and then turned back around to clean it up for about the next hour and a half without saying a word. To this day, we've really no idea what caused the explosion. Thus was born the Great Onion Incident of 2019. I'm sure Connor's unique nature spawned dozens of such stories throughout his days at Westchester. I really wish I could recount them all. Connor is a wonderfully literal guy. The most honest person I know. And when you speak the truth, whatever happens is the best possible thing that could have happened. And Connor is the truth personified. He's the best thing that could have happened to all of us in his years here at Westchester, and we'll really miss him. Thank you.
Cleveland Gordon Armentrout, son of Michael and Sheila Armentrout.
One of my favorite cartoon characters growing up, much like many of the adults in this room today, was Mighty Mouse. And if I had known 4 years ago what I know today, Cleveland Armentrout's soccer nickname would have been Mighty Mouse. The love of flying, the incredible speed, and the amazing strength, Cleveland simply packs a mighty punch. Mighty Mouse's catchphrase was, "Here I come to save the day." Cleveland will be leaving us in a few weeks to begin his journey at the U.S. Air Force Academy in Colorado. This dude right here will be flying fighter jets protecting our great country. The motto of the U.S. Air Force is, "Integrity first, service before self, excellence in all we do." I have met very few students in my 23 years at Westchester that embody this way of life in everything they are about more than Cleveland. It has been an incredible honor to coach Cleveland on the varsity soccer team over the last 4 years. And I knew when I first met him before seventh grade soccer camp, this was a very special and a unique young man. You never forget the name Cleveland Armentrout. And trust me, nobody at Westchester will ever forget what Cleveland stands for and all the Wildcats he has positively affected, young and old. A soccer state champion, all-state sprinter, school record holder in the 100 and 200 meters, nobody is faster. But the strength and honor that this young man portrays in all he does is simply motivational. When Cleveland wrote his captain's essay for me before senior year, he wrote, "My primary goal this year is to leave a lasting impact on my teammates and to set a good example of how to be a good person on the field, in the classroom, and outside of school." Cleveland, you did that and so much more. Now go fly away and save the day. The U.S. Air Force needs mighty men like you. Congrats.
Grayson Lee Boyette, son of Jenny Philo and Kelvin Boyette.
Talk. The first time I met Grayson Boyette, he was an eighth grader in my language arts class. It was a class with only six or seven students on the roster, and if you know Grayson like I know Grayson, then you may have predicted that this unique class size gave him and I more than enough opportunities to get acquainted. When I sat down to write this speech, I thought about all of our interactions, the many perfectly timed one-liners flung at me from our resident comedian, the vast multitudes of creative license he took with writing prompts I provided, the devilish grin that rise on his face each time he'd willingly dive onto the underdog side of a debate. Over the next 4 years, Grayson would go on to provide me with at least a million ways to tribute him in this speech. He's a skilled craftsman, a master of multiple languages, an agricultural genius, a spiritual powerhouse, a deep critical thinker, and a model son and brother. But one thing I appreciate most about Grayson is his ability to spread joy as a comedic writer. This young man has the ability to dream up anything and everything, and his writing often took the form of one of the world's truly great literary styles, the satirical news article, a la The Onion. From time to time, Grayson would write them, and then slip one of these articles onto my desk when I was out of the room, and I'd come back to complete and utter hilarity. Often, Grayson's articles would appear on my desk at the exact right moment, at the precise time I desperately needed to laugh. So, Grayson, I thought it fitting to return the favor and deliver the rest of your tribute in the most glorious and definitely not fake at all forms. The headline: Senior Tribute Speaker Comes to Humbling Realization in Front of Live Audience, Wesley Memorial Church. Extremely handsome and super young middle school teacher, Frank Morelli, made a startling realization while delivering a tribute to a graduating senior at Westchester Country Day School's annual commencement ceremony today, when he came to the conclusion, after many years of study, that the student he is speaking on behalf of, Mr. Grayson Boyette, is actually his true role model. "I felt sorry for him," said Boyette, one day in the distant past, as he donned a Morelli-esque fit of an untucked button-down over wrinkled khakis and blue chucks. So I dressed up as him once on Spirit Day in eighth grade out of pure solidarity. And well, the dude never realized I've been Jedi mind-tricking him ever since. Boyette's tutelage of Morelli was subtle and almost untraceable, but it ultimately came to the surface in real time. I didn't really have any marketable skills, Morelli admitted, directly from the podium. But then I reflected on all the times Grayson would just appear in my classroom out of the fog, and suddenly I couldn't fight the urge to carve Mandarin characters into solid wood with a butter knife while simultaneously delivering a newborn calf into the world. With Boyette's purely osmotic style of tutelage, Morelli now seems to be well on his way to a successful career at some point in the very distant future. I just felt like I needed to take the young man under my wing, Boyette added, as he tinkled the first few notes of Beethoven's Fifth into a random piano that just happened to appear next to him as he was interviewed for this piece. I hope with just a few more years of dedicated training, we can finally get Frank to where he needs to be. Related article, Queen's University campus literally sinks into the earth under weight of incoming students' sheer knowledge. Grayson, your humor and your spirit are unique and irreplaceable entities in our Westchester community that I will sorely miss in the future, but I know that you will bring them with you to Charlotte in the fall, and I know the folks at Queen's University will be blessed with a worthy and clever role model to follow forever. Congratulations, my friend.
Robert Thomason Brigman, son of Brack and Emily Brigman.
There has been a lot of talk in the news and on social media recently about NIL deals for high school athletes. And honestly, it is kind of insane and crazy. However, if Bo Brigman was going to be in high school for a few more years, I would have the perfect deal for him. What time is it? Bo time! Hold that up. Nobody has consumed more chicken tenders in their lifetime than that of Westchester's very own Bo Brigman, and I'm sure Bojangles would love to do business with him. Now, over the last couple of years, he has added cheese pizza, chocolate milk, and mac and cheese to his ever-growing palate. But I think for 15 years, he pretty much survived on tenders. I have watched this gentle giant grow since birth, from trusted soccer ball boy to loyal camper, to captain of the varsity soccer team, I knew I could always count on Bobo. Bo would graciously play whatever position on our team that would put the entire team in the greatest position to be successful. Not all players can sacrifice offensive output and accolades to play defense, but Bo Brigman never wavered to always put the team first. Bo is an incredible teammate, wonderful son, and loyal younger brother. When I asked his older brother, Hamer, to tell me what Bo meant to him as he gets ready to graduate, his response, and I quote, "I know he is my younger brother, but I really look up to Bo. He has great character and is a good soul. I am so proud of how strong he has grown through the years, both physically and mentally." Now, for those of you who really know these two brothers and how much they have competed through the years, this is a huge statement on all fronts, and I'm so proud to be a part of this team building. Emily and Brack, this may be our greatest victory ever. Bo, it's your time now. Go to state, don't be a chicken, and show everybody how truly awesome you are. Don't ever forget where you came from and what made you so strong. We are all so proud of you.
Zane Shore Dinkins, son of the late Jeff Dinkins and Beverly Dinkins.
Zane never moved that slow on the basketball court, thank goodness. So when I know I might have one of these speeches for a graduate, I'll start jotting down some notes over the course of the year. Let's just say I had a bunch on Zane, but this is just a tidbit of these notes. Zane came to us as a senior transfer from one of our conference rivals. Let me start by saying when he played at his former school, their entire student body was rooting against our team. I only noticed this because in watching the post-game tape, I kept seeing their fans extremely demonstrative when Zane would make a play. Amazingly, their entire student section was rooting for Zane, while again rooting against us. First of all, I never noticed the fans, and secondly, Zane must have left quite an impression for someone coming back to play and gain favor with his former fans, all while putting up 20-plus points in his best game of the season. Zane came to our team and made an immediate impact as our only senior. He set the bar for helping to change our team culture by showing up with a great attitude and truly putting in the work. During our first game of the season, we were all tied up with 8 seconds remaining. Zink hit the game-winning shot as time expired for the win, a walk-off three-point game winner in his first game as a Wildcat. Our gym went absolutely bonkers, and it was storybook. Immediately after that game, and completely at different times, Zane and his mother, Beverly, both humbly came up to me and thanked me for giving Zane an opportunity. I'm like, give him an opportunity. He completely deserves this. There's a quote that says, "Success occurs when opportunity meets preparation." Zane completely embodied that quote all year long. In his own words, Zane once mentioned that he was, quote, "that chubby kid that always got picked last." Well, Zane, you are the hardest working player I've ever coached and a number one pick through and through. Your Meraki legacy will be leaving our program better than you found it by showing your teammates that success happens through relentless hard work. A very wise person in your life says, quote, "Z is so much like his dad in so many ways. Laid back, witty, aggravating, and adorable at the same time. And most of all, he genuinely looks for the best in people." Zane, we are so proud of you, and I'm sure your dad would be so proud of you as well. I love you, buddy, and congratulations.
Emma Eileen Engel, daughter of Mark Engel and Anita McCauley.
Cinderella was known for her one spectacular pair of shoes. Emma, on the other hand, has 43 pairs of shoes. Let me tell you about four. Soccer cleats, gripping, agile. Coach Miller stated, Emma was such a hard worker, truly gave her all every day. She wanted to be her best and wanted everyone around her to be their best. Irish step dance shoes, built for quick moves, sturdy, flexible. Mr. Smith reported, by the end of the year in AP Euro, I would call out an essay prompt and we would play Emma versus ChatGPT. It was amazing how fast both could produce a high quality thesis. More often than not, the two were almost identical in their responses. Character shoes, versatile, supportive. Miss Albert remarked, "What a great role model Emma has been for my children. She always greets them by name and asks about their days each time she sees them on campus. The extra time she puts into enriching their lives is characteristic of Emma. She loves to do for others and finds such joy in doing so." Tennis shoes. Comfortable, easygoing. Emma is comfortable to be around. Conversations flow and are unrestrained. Mr. Atkinson added, in AP Lit, Emma loved a good argument and was a great collaborator with her peers. Emma, as you walk across Wake Forest Courtyard, no doubt in a new pair of shoes, to be true to yourself and you will go far. Are you ready for your last bow?
Elizabeth Rose Foster, daughter of Frank and Betsy Foster.
Liza, wait, something seems off here. It's the hat. Go ahead. Now, let's go. Let's go, Liza. I've used these three words many times over the past 4 years. Whether due to your hesitancy to jump into the pool for warm-ups or while cheering you on, today is a bit of both. The uncertainty of moving forward and the excitement of completing this journey successfully. Looking back on a conversation we had recently about living and learning, this process involves acquiring experiences as well as knowledge. They come together at different stages and speeds, just like your artwork. There's a blend of excitement and disappointment, struggles and joy, comfort and discomfort. It's this blending together of all these different shades and colors, both the good and the bad, into one beautiful, unique design, which is life. Just like how you find comfort in wearing this hat and discomfort in wearing this dress, both seem necessary in order for you to graduate today. You, Liza, are bold, just like your art. You complement and complete. Give without expectations, stand out without overshadowing. These are the things that make you unique. So just like the fun drawings you would do on all the kids at summer swim meets, they were all unique experiences that also encouraged your teammates. And though the drawings may have washed away, the memories and your impact have not. Now, let's go, Liza, on to life's next journey.
Caroline Elise Anderson Griffith, daughter of Suzanne Lowe and Lincoln Griffith.
Caroline Griffith, a short artsy film in words and phrases. Superimpose. When she looked at life through the camera, she felt like she could finally see it, Catherine Howe. The camera fades in on a boisterous fourth grade classroom. A group of young students collaborate on a poster with their crayons and markers. Two more build with Lego blocks on the carpet below the window, and a few others organize and reorganize the prized trinkets they store inside their desks. At the center of it all, a girl with bright blonde hair stands and observes. She measures the scene, determines the right shots and angles, and stores it all away in her mind for an eventual film of the future. Flash forward. It's 6 years later. The camera zooms to a close-up shot of the same girl, her blonde hair now streaked in the assorted hues of her choosing. She sits at her old desk in room 316, Kester Hall. She's alone, her hands shaking. Everything is suddenly new in her life, and she's not sure which direction to head. But she wipes a tear from her eye and smiles at her old eighth grade teacher sitting across from her. She decides to slip on her favorite pair of Chuck Taylors and take the ultimate leap of faith, to be herself completely and at all times, to use her unique and precise vision, her camera, to reflect back to all of us the striking ways in which she's able to see the world. Flash forward again. It's junior year. The camera dives down from a bird's eye shot of a jam-packed rock concert in the lower school carpool circle and zooms in on the girl once again, this time as she splashes the crescendo of her band's encore performance into the cymbals and mops the sweat from her brow. A group of lower school students rushes the stage. They crowd around the girl, firing off questions and basically asking for autographs. The girl might not know it at this precise moment, but in time she'll realize that all of the hard work, all the late nights and early mornings she spent playing her guitar and smashing the drums and perfecting the sweetest and strongest tone of voice, the many hours of film editing, all of the chances she took to put herself out there, has transformed her into a bona fide rock star and an inspiration to an entire community. Flash forward to now, this very moment. The camera zooms in on an aging middle school English teacher who's about to break down on stage in front of 1,000 people. Because the girl standing next to him, the same blonde-headed fourth grader, has provided him and our entire community a first-hand look at one of the most beautiful artistic journeys in school history. And now the English teacher knows this portion of the girl's journey must unfortunately come to an end. But don't worry. Sorry. This film doesn't fade to black. The credits don't roll like all the others. There will be no previews for the sequel. No, this film rolls forever. Because as George Lucas put it, you found the things that you love enough to take risks. And because, like Steven Spielberg said, you don't dream at night. You dare to dream at day. And Caroline, you dream all day. Orson Welles once said, a film never really good unless the camera is an eye in the head of a poet. Caroline Griffith is that poet. And her camera is the eye that holds all of her varied experiences, all the leaps of faith she's ever taken in her life. And it gives her the power to share with us the clarity we all so desperately need. The ability to see the world as Caroline sees it, in all of its brilliant glory. NYU Film School is getting a truly unique and special artist next fall. They're not going to know what hit them. Congratulations, Caroline.
Caleb Michael Hammond, son of Joey and Rebecca Hammond.
Caleb Hammond was born in a home devoted to baseball. Its virtues, its disciplines, its rhythms. Essayist Donald Hall wrote, "Baseball is a game of punctuated stillness, of dramatic seconds surrounded by casual hours." So, how does one succeed in a sport that requires such stillness, concentration, and patience? How does one succeed in life, which often requires those virtues? Well, if you listen very carefully, I'll share the secret of Caleb's success. You have to be very quiet. Do you hear it? It's silence. Proverbs 17:27 says, "He who restrains his words has knowledge, and he who has a cool spirit is a man of understanding." A perfect description of Caleb. As a child, he quietly honored his parents and heeded their words. As his mom looked at him with tears in her eyes outside the kindergarten suite on the first day of school, he asked, "Are you okay, Mom?" She said, "I'm okay, so you can be okay too." And he bravely walked in. Lower school teachers admired his self-discipline, intrinsic motivation, and the fact that he was that greatly desired student, one who could be still and listen. Middle school teachers and coaches admired his sportsmanship, work ethic, but most of all, his moral compass. They watched him quietly walk away from peers in situations that took a turn in the wrong direction. In high school, he spoke with his GPA and his bat. Honored as a junior marshal, playing in 2 state championship finals, and receiving a scholarship to play baseball at High Point University, he maintained a spirit of humility and integrity. And here we stand today. Caleb is poised to step to the plate at the Willard Stadium and sit in HPU classrooms with that cool, humble, and calm demeanor. Fueled by his family's support and personal faith, he is indeed ready to play ball.
Lucy Larkin Rose Hurd, daughter of Bill and Whitney Hurd.
My team here. Before we get started, I thought I'd give you an iced latte. And some fashion for Georgia. Oh yeah. Lucy, otherwise, some of you will remember this, known as LL Cool H, is always happy and ready for an adventure and fun, no matter the circumstances. Her gorgeous and infectious smile and boundless energy has lifted our spirits and inspired us all to be our best selves. Lucy's love for family and friends is really what shapes Lucy. She's always been there to be our loyal friend, to lend a helping hand, and to offer a listening ear, or to simply just make us laugh when we need it most. All of these characteristics also allow her to be an unwavering and ever-supportive teammate, especially on the soccer field and on the tennis courts. Her sense of style is truly unparalleled, as we have all looked for her fashion inspiration on more than one occasion. Whether she's rocking a bold new accessory, like that, or putting her own spin on something new and classic. And do you know, Lucy has been thinking of her outfits for sorority life in the fall all year long. But beyond her fashion sense and her fun-loving nature, she has a heart of gold. She's always there to support you, to be a shoulder to lean on, and Lucy never meets a stranger. Her kindness and her generosity shines through in everything that she does. But don't let her fool you. She is bigger than sweet and a happy-go-lucky girl. And I know this for a fact because some of our best conversations have come from her just popping in the middle of class. And I would say, "Lucy, where are you supposed to be?" And she's like, "In the bathroom." So But I always welcomed her visits, though, and Lucy was always serving as kind of like my assistant life coach because she would help me with other students tackle lessons in different ways. She has a unique way of looking at the world, and her perspectives always left me feeling inspired, energy, and thinking we need more Lucys in the world. She has that infectious energy that uplifts everyone around her, and it just makes you want to go be her partner in crime, no matter what she's going to do. I think you would be an outstanding life coach. We are so excited to see you thrive in Georgia this fall, and I know that you're going to make a positive impact on every single person you meet. Your presence in our lives has been a gift, and we are all better for knowing you. So when you find yourself drinking your iced latte and the Student Center at the University of Georgia, remember what a beautiful person you are, inside and out, and continue to leave your mark on this world. Georgia is so lucky to get you, and I'm going to miss you.
Cruz Alexander Hessling, son of Lee and Lori Hessling.
The last of Stephen Covey's seven habits of highly effective people is sharpen the saw. Now, to the novice reader, this habit may seem elusive because first, we must be aware of our saw, and then learn balance. But Cruz is no novice. Cruz had a stint playing soccer before devoting his high school career to running. And unless you're visiting from out of town today, you've seen Cruz running, probably shirtless, down Abbots Creek Church Road or around Westchester. And once your envy settled, admiration took over. This is how I felt for 2 years watching Cruz come into class. Every day, Cruz was doing something productive. Eating a healthy home-prepared snack, using a foam roller, massage gun, fireflies, doing anything to get that competitive advantage. Or he might pick up the guitar and serenade the pre-class chatter with a bit of Tracy Chapman. Highly gifted in academics, male athlete of the year, winner of the Art Award, and the best runner in Westchester history, Cruz can be content to rock his musical gift as just background. Balance. Sharpen the saw. But Cruz is not meant for background. He's meant for the forefront. He'll be running on a scholarship at UNC Charlotte this fall, part of their Honors College, and he finished up high school in honorary fashion. About the only thing that could prevent the state's fastest 2A runner from winning multiple state titles this year happened. Cruz got sick. He noticed in his first run that he was not going to be close to his best, so after strategizing with Coach Anderson, Cruz did what only someone of Cruz's class could do. He sacrificed any chance he might have of winning individual titles to devote all of his energy to helping the relay team place in their event. He put team before self, virtue at its finest, and they placed. Keep cruising, young man. All the best in Charlotte, and congratulations.
Bryce Elliott Hooker, son of Joseph and Samantha Hooker.
Good morning. I just want to say what an honor it is to be here to give this tribute out for Bryce Hooker. There's a lot of things in this life that can be easily explained away, things you can make excuses for, actions that you can blame on others, but there's one thing in life that cannot just be written off, and that's your character. Your character says a lot about who you are inside and what you are as a person, in this case, what you are as a man. From the moment I met Bryce Hooker, I knew that his character was solid and never changing. The things that he stood for, the things that he said meant something to him. You can see it in the way that he carried himself, and you can feel it every time you talk to him. And I'm sure there's some of you out there that might be saying, oh, he's just saying all this because Bryce asked him to do his speech. To quote our baseball team, I can say, no shot. I trust in Bryce's character so much that whenever we go on vacation, Bryce is the one that comes over, stays at our house, and watches my two dogs, my two babies. That's trust. More importantly, Bryce's character is so well-founded that this year I allowed him to take my daughter to her senior prom. Any father that has a daughter know what kind of trust that is in his character. Bryce, I am so proud of you. And I'm so lucky to have coached you over these past 3 years. Your growth at Westchester has been immeasurable, most especially in your belief in yourself, your leadership, and your desire to be a force in this world. And that's what you're going to be, a force in this world. I know this again because of your character. Your character is setting you up for achievement, happiness, and growth. Try not to cry. I can't wait to see where your character takes you from here. And I know as you make your way down to Florida to play baseball for Tallahassee Community College, that those coaches are going to find out just as fast as I did how special your character is. Congratulations to you and your family, and thank you for everything.
Jacob Sawyer Johnson, son of Dustin Johnson and Lori Potter.
So, what do the chemical element radium and the video game Fortnite have in common? Obviously, the answer is Jacob Johnson. During our elements project in honors chemistry, Jacob decided to build his Bohr model for his element radium using Fortnite's free build mode as his medium. When Jacob brought his actual PlayStation to school to show us his atom in the game, I learned a couple key things about him. First, while I already knew that he was skilled at math and science, this project was my first glimpse at his propensity for engineering. It clearly took hours of actual work to construct the electron rings with all 88 electrons of this very large element. The second thing it showed me is that Jacob insists on not just living, but enjoying his life. When faced with the project requirements, he found a solution that aligned with his interests, so he spent his time in a way that was both meaningful and fun. During AP chemistry, where Jacob's superb number sense really had a chance to shine, Jacob shared how fortunate he felt to get such a strong foundation in his core algebra skills. Shout out to Ms. Noyes, because he knows that that foundation has allowed him to build the mathematical part of his brain that's so integral to who he is. This moment of genuine insight showed me that Jacob values the skills and knowledge he's obtained through education, both of which are much more important than any letters on a transcript. This is why Jacob chose to take courses like AP Chemistry and AP Calculus and tackled such a topic as quantum physics for his senior capstone speech, because he knows the level his brain is capable of working at, and he simply isn't going to waste his time not learning at his highest possible level. Jacob, your ability to combine a strong foundation of knowledge with both creativity and actual enjoyment makes me certain that whatever field of science you ultimately land on, you will be producing solutions that are as efficient, concise, and effective as possible. In a world where wasting time, wasting resources, and wasting potential happy moments is such a common pitfall, we are lucky to have minds like yours going out into the world. Congratulations, Jacob.
Quinto Kiamalathong, son of V and B Kiamalathong.
Almost 5 years ago, our community enjoyed an amazing stroke of good fortune. We welcomed a new eighth grade student to Westchester named Quinto Kiamalathong. The young man arrived promptly on the first day of school, sporting his trademark pair of specs with his glorious locks flowing down past his eyelids. It became apparent right away that he possessed a unique and magnetic sense of humor that placed him at the center of many, many social interactions, and at most times of the day. A gifted soccer player, a budding track star, an occasional clown of the classroom variety, it would have been easy to typecast a young man like Quinto, except he never allowed it to happen, because from his very first moment at Westchester, Quinto proved to be a man of many surprises. I still remember a character analysis essay Quinto wrote in eighth grade literature about the characters Boo Radley from To Kill a Mockingbird and Ponyboy Curtis from The Outsiders that he titled, "What You See Is Not What You Get." So I guess I shouldn't have been surprised each time over the last few years when Quinto casually stopped by my classroom just to talk about a new piece of literature he read or to offer me book recommendations for my personal reading. And all those times I watched Quinto streak down the sidelines on the varsity soccer pitch or the time we saw him celebrate a state championship victory, I should have iced my surprise when he would stop by at the end of the next school day to discuss the merits and shortcomings of existentialism while firing off direct quotes from Simone de Beauvoir and Friedrich Nietzsche as if they're posted on billboards up and down Route 40. For a young man who faced so much change, so much adversity and loss at an early age, what surprises me most about Quinto is that he continues to dive headlong into life with such positive energy. But it shouldn't surprise me at all. Not as I look out into the pews today and see Quinto's family staring, smiling back at us, the place where Quinto both derives and directs all of his power, into being a loving son and a caring, considerate brother, into being a young man whose words and deeds matter so much to him that he's willing to mark them on his arms for all to see, into being a young man who could fire a shot upper 90 or flat out run past you just as easily as he can produce a work of fine art or play a piano concerto or make a new friend. The ancient Greek philosopher Heraclitus said, "No man ever steps in the same river twice, for it's not the same river and he's not the same man." To me, this is the essence of Quinto Kiamalathong, man of mystery and surprise, who constantly grows, who searches for knowledge and wisdom at every turn, and who rarely seeks shelter in his own personal comfort zone. So this fall, as Quinto takes the Ole Miss campus by storm with his infectious personality and his varied talents, I promise I won't be the least bit surprised. Congratulations, Quinto.
Elizabeth Lassiter, daughter of Angela and the late Stephen Lassiter.
Some personalities are so special they deserve two nicknames. As manager of the soccer team, Drew is sunshine, and in the halls of Mr. Smith's classroom, she sparkles. Most spirited cheerleader for our Wildcats, this little aura of energy has made us all cheer, smile, and even laugh at some point during this year. Now, not just a little laugh, but a Drew Lassiter sunshine sparkles laugh. It's a bit of a cackle that turns into a contagious, boisterous laughter, real laughter, laughter that's good for the soul. And that's exactly why she does it. It's good for the soul. Her senior speech was devoted to educating her community on the psychological and physiological benefits of laughter. And her example over her years here has modeled just that. When we sincerely laugh, we feel a bit better. Being around sunshiny, sparkly, sincere people like Drew helps us laugh more, feel better, things we all need more of. Drew is the model daughter, a devoted sister, and she is loved by this upper school community. Ask anyone about Drew and they will say heartwarming things. Drew is the recipient of the Susie Holloman Humanitarian Award this year, given to the upper school student who is always kind and friendly and who goes out of his or her way to exhibit this behavior. I will miss watching Drew rein in the upper school boys to teach them the homecoming dance. I will miss having her sparkly cheerleading influence in the blue and white tutu around our campus with my daughter here next year. But Drew's legacy of laughter will not be forgotten. Now it's time for her to go be a cheerleader at Queens University, and perhaps a nursing career afterwards. I, for one, know wherever she is and whatever she's doing, those beside her are blessed. Queens has a new ray of sunshine on its way. Keep sparkling, Drew, and congratulations.
Skylar Reese Manning, daughter of Matt and Jamie Soule.
Resilient, able to withstand or recover from difficult conditions. Dedicated, devoted to a task or purpose, having single-minded loyalty or integrity. These adjectives immediately come to mind when I think of Skylar Manning. My perception of her has not changed with her maturation from a sophomore in my Algebra 2 class to the woman she is today. I am simply more convinced my initial impression of Skylar was correct. From her academics to her friendships and her athletic commitments, Skylar has maintained a level of consistent dedication and resilience not always seen in a high school student. Dedicated to growing and developing as a student, she not only sought out her teachers for assistance, she also shared her knowledge and understanding of difficult concepts generously with her classmates. These traits continued on the pool deck as a member of the Westchester swim team. Unable to swim the full season this year because of rotator cuff surgery, she showed unwavering dedication to the team by acting as a student coach for the second half of the season. Mrs. Marsh used a much more concise, fitting descriptor for Skylar, saying she has grit. Grit means courage and resolve, strength of character. I could share many other anecdotes demonstrating these attributes in Skylar, things gleaned from our conversations both inside and outside of the classroom. But let me just close by saying this. This girl has grit. It will see her through this new chapter at Clemson University. I look forward to seeing where else it takes her. Congratulations, Skylar.
Madeline Blake McWhorter, daughter of Blake and Amy McWhorter.
I met Madeline her sophomore year. I knew she was studious. I thought of her as being very quiet. Wow, was I completely snowed. Madeline is known as being super sharp and intelligent by her teachers. Mrs. Albert describes her as a strong reader and a thoughtful writer. I taught her history and math. She completed her online AP Econ course in my classroom this year, all while combating an almost debilitating case of senioritis. Madeline's spicy personality began to peek through her quiet demeanor as we got to know each other better. She is known for her wicked sense of humor and storytelling prowess. Her after-school job at the Y provided plenty of material. Just ask Mr. Smith. Madeline has an infectious laugh unlike any other I've heard. I immediately know who is on my hall when I hear it, and it always lifts my mood. What has impressed me most about Madeline is her fierce independence and honesty. She is unapologetically herself, take it or leave it. Opinionated and not afraid to defend her positions, that is Madeline. I have loved listening to her both in class and in study hall and will miss our conversations. Madeline, continue to be your fabulously fierce and independent self. You will do great things at Ole Miss. Congratulations.
Anna Elizabeth Merritt, daughter of Colin and Avery Merritt.
Mia, Serena, Steffi, there have been many iconic women sports athletes who everyone remembers by their first name. For all of us at Westchester, it's simply AB. Now, technically, that would be two names, Anna Beth, but for as long as I can remember, there's only one AB who has dominated the volleyball, basketball, and soccer stadiums all around North Carolina like this special Wildcat. The other name that you may have heard Anna Beth often referred to is Pickle. And when I asked her friends and even her brother, Jack, nobody knew why or when this nickname of Pickle came about. So I did a little research. There are many types of pickles in the world. Sour pickles, sweet pickles, spicy pickles, and the list can go on. But arguably, the best pickles around are dill pickles. And that's it. AB is the real dill. Now, AB has been known to be sour, sweet, and spicy at times, but one thing is for sure, you always knew what you were getting when you opened the jar. A tough, competitive, I got your back teammate. AB, I think I can speak for everyone in this room today who watched you compete wearing a Westchester uniform over the last 7 years. That's right. 21 straight seasons. AB left it all on the court and field. You and I both know it wasn't easy, and you had some of those bumps in the road that even formed on the greatest of pickles. But in the end, you are going down as not only one of the greatest goalies in school history, but also one of the greatest competitors. Although I never officially coached you on a team, I always felt like you took my informal coaching and made yourself better each and every season. A three-time All-State goalie and two-time Westchester Athlete of the Year doesn't come without hours of work and dedication. Congratulations on all your successes in and out of the classroom. And please take this jar of the finest pickles with you to Chapel Hill, because I know you may just need to be reminded of what a big deal you are.
Now, Natalie Caroline Roberts, daughter of John Roberts, Sean Love, and Sarah and Jody Cook.
Thomas Jefferson once said, "I'm a great believer in luck, and I find the harder I work, the more I have of it." When Natty finished her senior speech about women in STEM, Mrs. Albert and I looked at each other and said, "Now that's how a senior speech is done." Natty made the bridge from her devotion to dancing, starting at age 2 and competitively at 5, to women becoming more the powerhouse they can be in the engineering world. I have zero doubt that Natty will cross any bridge she needs, or she'll build one of her own, because Natty does everything like she did her senior speech, with hard work. Nobody works harder than Natty Roberts. Ask her volleyball coach, who gave her the coach's award. Ask Cleveland. He says the ones who care work 75% of the time in study hall. Natty works 90%, copying and recopying notes till they're perfect. When finished, she lets the others have them, and others take them, because they're that good. When my second daughter was born, my all-male class made me a little book called The ABCs of A-Push. From the Alamo to the Zimmerman note, they had a little picture and word per laminated page. I used it to teach the next years, and when I had Natty, my perfect little Molly pitcher, she presented me with a gift on our final day of class. As a way to review for her exam, she created this big, beautiful book of terms that encapsulated our year. She labeled it The ABCs of A-Push, but better. And that is Natty. With her work ethic, she just does things better. She goes with scholarships to the honors program at Auburn University to become a chemical engineer, and Auburn's a good fit for Natty. The Auburn Creed begins, "I believe that this is a practical world and I can count on only what I earn. Therefore, I believe in work, hard work." Natty, your talents and hard work have won you the respect of us all. Keep inspiring those around you to do their best. War Eagle, and congratulations.
Aliana Grace Schwartz, daughter of Adam and Heather Schwartz. Whether you have known Ollie Schwartz since birth or have just been introduced to her this morning, you already know she is smart, hardworking, and meets very high expectations set for herself and has the awards to prove it. So my job today is to peel back the mask and educate you on the sides of Ollie reserved for only a few. Now, Ollie, coming from a fellow middle child myself, I know we must take our anonymous sources' insights with a grain of salt. So in David Letterman style, the category today is top 10 secrets you never knew about Ollie Schwartz. Number 10. Ollie Schwartz can teach you how to lose. An anonymous source reports that every night before dinner, the young Schwartz children would play soccer in their backyard. Ollie always won. The same can be said for anyone who raced against her in the last 4 years in cross country and track. Ollie is number one. Say it, Coleman. Ollie is number one. Number 9, Ollie Schwartz is a great cook. From baked goods to warm lunches for her brothers, Ollie is a talented chef, and she's loyal too. 2 years of working for companies coming, and she still won't share the chicken salad or chocolate chip cookie recipes. Number 8, Ollie has 2 treasured and highly guarded possessions, her candy bucket and her duct tape collection. Number 7, Ollie is strategic. In family Monopoly games, Ollie always manages to be the banker, and somehow always ends up winning. Ollie's number one. Number 6, Ollie can handle herself. While reffing in the High Point Youth Soccer League, she faced parents who had not been coached in the wildcat way of being a fan, who hurled insults and profanity at her. Too bad she couldn't put them in a headlock, and here she's pretty good at that. Number 5, Ollie does not like French fries, peas, or having her toenails clipped. Number 4, Ollie respects obligation. Ollie has shouldered gracefully the obligation that accompanies family in happy times and in great loss. Number 3, Ollie overcomes obstacles. Ollie was diagnosed with exercise-induced laryngeal obstruction. During strenuous exercise, which is all Ollie does, her vocal cords don't open on inhalation. After researching this ailment herself, she underwent years of therapy to be able to manage it with strategies that required calmness of mind and fortitude of spirit in a terrifying moment. The results? An individual cross-country conference championship and many school records. Number two, Ollie sees a problem and creates a solution. She spent countless hours learning how to create, market, and sell adaptive stuffed animals for children with injuries or physical disabilities. She also navigated homesick campers as a camp seafarer counselor. Visions of rainbows and unicorns did the trick. She may have summoned her inner Sue Horny. And number one, Ollie truly cares. She is a great listener who supports parents Heather and Adam, brothers Mikey and Coleman, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, teachers, coaches, and wildcats galore with utter devotion. Ollie, as you head off to the UVA, know your secrets are safe with me. Congratulations. Sophie Caroline Marie Stafaris, daughter of Bart Stafaris and Veronique Freya.
Considering Sophie's capstone project and the fact that she took literally every single science course offered to her at Westchester, she's clearly very passionate about science. And yet she's never limited herself to just being a science person. She balances academic excellence across all the disciplines, extracurriculars, friendships, and a myriad of other hobbies so well that the commonly used term well-rounded almost feels inadequate. Especially because to me, the most remarkable thing about Sophie's well-roundedness is her authentically good heart. A heart overflowing with generosity, empathy, and wisdom well beyond her years. She's one of the kindest people I've ever met, but is simultaneously unafraid to offer constructive criticism when it needs to be heard. From her trademark, "Okay, let's get started," when her AP chemistry classmates took too long to settle down, to the candid feedback she provided to me to help improve my teaching, I've learned that if you are fortunate enough to be getting advice from Sophie, it would be wise to listen. During our Model UN trips this year, Sophie perfectly balanced working hard with playing hard. After committees, she had the self-discipline to spend some time working on calculus homework, but then also joined us in games like charades and, of course, jumping on the bouncy pad at Misty Mountain Lodge. And rather than sleep in, Sophie was my dependable morning reading buddy. Just as her personality brings so many different threads of life together, we've all seen how Sophie crochets what were once simple strands of yarn into something beautiful, useful, cuddly, or all three. The variety of her crocheting projects perfectly mirrors the wide scope of her interests, just as the giving and donating of those creations mirrors her sweeping generosity. And the best part is that now, Sophie, you get to expand your well-rounded horizons even further. I know that you'll continue to get the most out of what life has to offer while always giving even more of yourself back in return. Congratulations, Sophie.
Jae Yun Tin, son of Fun Tien and Cho Hun Shu.
Day one of my play production class, I typically ask the student to tell us a little something about themselves and why they have chosen the selective. I started with Jack, as he was my only senior, and Jack said, "I'm here to get my art credit." I told him I appreciated his honesty. Now, Jack's direct style would often catch me off guard, and his dry sense of humor and his quick wit could often take the sting out of the heat that would slowly burn me as I figured it out, and then he would chuckle and give the shrug with that awesome smile that he often does after burning me. Jack's direct and thoughtful questions about scenery, lighting, and sound showed a concern for the actors. He worked to ensure that they would be seen, heard, and on cue. Jack volunteered to help with stage lighting during the fall school musical, Moana. During Moana, Jack and I worked closely together as we created lighting scenes to capture all of the movement on stage. Jack and I found that following the script too closely can hurt if the actors are moving at a different pace. A few times while Jack was in the script, I'd be fussing, "Look at the stage." And then Jack would be looking at the stage and I'd be, "Look at the script." Jack is a quick learner though, and he had the lights working right on cue. In the spring, Jack returned to the light booth for the lower school musical production of Pirates Past Noon, and also possibly just to get higher to his true calling, which is aerospace engineering. I was so proud to have an upper schooler working with me on our lower school show. It's Jack's attention to detail and his quick processing of new skills that will serve him well as he continues his education in engineering at Virginia Tech this fall. Congratulations, Jack, and go easy on those professors with the burn.
Thank you, thank you.
Ruhan Upadhyay, son of Nihar and Janki Upadhyay.
So Ruhan is the greatest science question asker in Westchester history. So I imagine he asked me a question about his favorite topic today, memes. Anyone who knows or saw Ruhan's senior speech knows that he loves them. The thing was full of them. And they can be funny, or unusual, or edgy, or cringe-inducing, or inappropriate. But they actually have a biological origin. The word meme is a scientific term developed by Sir Richard Dawkins, one of the most venerated evolutionary biologists of the 20th century. He described them as the cultural equivalent of the genes held in all of our DNA, an evolving and replicable data set. And they can refer to any discrete piece of information or technology or ideology or a funny picture, or in Ruhan's case, a system of beliefs and behaviors. In his case, radical altruism. He is a true altruist. He has a selfless concern for the welfare of others. He asks for no recognition and seeks no reward. And anyone at school could give you tons of examples, but to name a few, he breakfasted with buddies at Northwood Elementary every single Friday. He woke up early to drive to school and spent times with the little ones he'd never met, and I took attendance every Friday morning and he was never there, so I don't think he ever missed one. Ruhan also took every opportunity to assist with other advisory's lunch cleanups, a task many students can't even be bothered to do for the 10 days required each year. He helps with other little ones too. I know he's an incredible big brother, but actually, and my AP biology students can tell you too, I can't say whether that's true altruism. After all, they share half their DNA, so biologically speaking, helping two brothers or like eight cousins is just as good as helping yourself. But this in no way diminishes the importance of his role. He's also, his concern for others takes him to the political arena, where at school he wrote and debated stridently for economic reforms and to end income inequality. In biology, he passionately spoke of and even presented on predatory pharmaceutical practices and promoted bioethical change in many arenas. He is, however, no ideologue, and his iconoclastic takes with nuance far beyond his years. There's an irony here with all of this. The book in which the word meme first appeared was named The Selfish Gene. It was not describing a gene for selfishness, however. Instead, it suggested that all genes and memes act only in their own self-interest to be replicated maximally. Well, I hope the Ruhan meme of radical altruism lives on and selfishly self-replicates until it's embedded in the minds of our entire Westchester population. We'll miss you, Ruhan. Congratulations.
Will the graduates please stand? And now, ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Westchester Country Day School Class of 2023. Congratulations.
Please stand. As we conclude this ceremony, our hearts are filled with gratitude for the faculty members, family, and friends that thoughtfully equipped and guided us. As we continue down our new paths departing Westchester, may we remember that dreams worth chasing are dreams of character, not dreams of career. As we seek and desire to stay true to ourselves, try to maintain and stand upon the integrity and virtues which have delivered us to this moment. We also must recognize that self-denial and servanthood are sometimes the tools necessary to change the world around us. Duty and joy are not mutually exclusive, and lasting success will ultimately come from delayed gratification. May we not forget that the things we do without genuine love are a pointless, clanging cymbal. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. It is loving, patient, kind, and forgiving. May we now all go forth with these virtues at the forefront of our lives. Amen, and congratulations.